our next chorus. I do, I surely do know that I've been born again. Number 113. Trust in Jesus, though storms assail, you have his promise, he will not fail. 244.
Good to see you all in God's house this evening. We welcome you, and especially if you're visiting with us, we give you a very warm welcome. We're going to open our service by singing a lovely hymn of testimony. It's 323 in our own hymn book. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found, was blind, but now I see. We're going to stand as we sing this lovely hymn.
I want.
We are very glad to have our brother Philip Berry in the meeting. I'm going to ask Philip to come up and open our meeting in a wee word of prayer. So let's bow our heads and close our eyes, and let's seek the Lord as we come into his presence this evening. Thank you, Philip. Bless you, Lord.
Bless you. Let us pray and ask for the Lord's blessing to be upon our service tonight. And it's lovely to have you here, but oh, how we need the Lord. It's his presence that makes the difference. And may we really sense that the Lord is among us, and that tonight our hearts will be spoken to in song and even through testimony. So let us pray together tonight. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for this opportunity of coming in to your presence on this Lord's Day evening. We thank you, Lord, for this great hymn that we have already been singing together, Amazing Grace. And Lord, we rejoice tonight in a full salvation. We thank you, Lord, for your mercy and your grace towards us, and that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. And we thank you for the good news of the gospel, and we rejoice tonight that our Savior is alive. And we thank you tonight, Lord, we have a life-giving message to proclaim. And Lord, we rejoice tonight that it's possible that even in this very house tonight, lives can be transformed and changed by the power of God. And we pray, O Lord, tonight that this meeting will be charged by the presence of the Holy Ghost. We pray that everything that is said, sung, and done will bring glory and honor to King Jesus. We pray, O Lord, that there'll be a real sense of thy presence among us. And Lord, that our hearts will be captivated by what is sung tonight and then what is said, even in testimony. We thank you, Lord, for salvation. We thank you, Lord, you're still saving. We thank you, Lord, you're still in the business of changing lives and transforming homes. And Lord, we pray that even as this congregation very shortly will go into a mission, we pray, Lord, that it'll be the greatest mission yet when multitudes will be won for Jesus Christ. Start that work tonight, we pray, Lord, in this place. Give help to our brother John as he ministers in song. We thank you for his ministry in the past. May he know the anointing of the Spirit of the Lord upon him. For our brothers, he testifies as well, Lord, give him help. May he know a real sense of the Lord's presence even here in the pulpit, and stand by him and guide him, and that every word that is said tonight, the Lord will speak into every life. Bless thy servant and his wife and family and the leadership of this congregation. And Lord, just continue to guide and direct them. And Lord, bless them as they serve thee here in this place. And we are mindful of those who need your touch tonight, those that are sick. Minister to their hearts, we pray, and lives. And Lord, for those who mourn, that you'll bring comfort. And Lord, we thank you for every happy memory of our late sister, Mrs. Walkinshaw, even in the college, as we were there and served the Lord and studied, and she was there as the matron. And we thank you for the years of service that you give to her. And Lord, we're glad, even in the midst of sorrow, that tonight she's at home with the Lord. And she's heard that, well done, thou good and faithful servant. But Lord, comfort the family and others tonight who mourn, bring solace to their heart. And Lord, that tonight they'll draw from thy wonderful and sufficient grace. So just close us in with thyself. Hedge us around with thy presence. Cover this meeting house in thy precious blood. Drive back the forces of evil, we pray. And that tonight you'll just, Lord, may we leave this place saying it was good to be here, for here we met afresh with the Lord. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. And all of God's people say it. Amen.
Amen. May the Lord bless our brother Philip as he continues to serve the Lord. We're delighted to have our brother John Porter with us tonight, no stranger to any of us. Always very willing to come and sing for us. John, we'll ask you to come and bring us a couple of messages and song. Thank you.
Good evening, everybody. Good to see you here. I know a lot of you don't understand me, just hopefully you'll understand the songs.
When I think of how he came so far from glory, came to dwell among the such as I to suffer shame and such disgrace. On Mount Calvary, take my place. Then I ask myself this question, who am I? Who am I that the King should lead and die for? Who am I that he should pray? Not my will, but thine, Lord. The answer I may never really know, why he ever loved me so, that to an old rugged cross he go, for who am I? When I'm reminded of these words, I'll leave thee never. Just be true, I'll give to you a life forever. Oh, I wonder what I could have done to deserve God's only Son, to fight my battles till they're won. Tell me, who am I? Who am I that the King should lead and die for? Who am I that he would pray? Not my will, but thine, Lord. Well, the answer I may never truly know, why he ever loved me so. And I ask myself this question, who am I? Yes, for that old rugged cross he'd go, for who am I?
Indeed, maybe you never asked yourself that question at all. Maybe that never enters your head. It enters my head, brave and often, because sometimes whenever you look at yourself in the mirror of Scripture, and remember Scripture is described as the glass that you look at, you know, you see your own self reflected, and whenever you see yourself reflected in his righteousness, well, don't we all fall far short of the mark within ourselves? Well, I do. The most amazing thing about our Saviour, I think, is the love that he's given to his enemies. Who were his enemies? Us boys. Has creation that turned his back on them. That's right. Love this owl. This is an owl owl song, an owl hymn. I'll sing just a couple of verses of it.
The love of God is greater far than tongue or pen can ever tell. It goes beyond the highest star and reaches to the lowest hell. The guilty pair bowed down with care. God gave his son to win. His erring child he reconciled and pardoned from his sin. Oh, love of God, how rich and pure, how measureless and strong. It shall forevermore endure the saints' and angels' song.
I love this old last verse here.
Could we with ink the ocean fill, or were the skies of parchment made, where every stalk on earth a quill, and every man a scribe by trade, to write the love of God above would drain that ocean dry. Nor could that scroll contain the whole, though stretched from sky to sky. Oh, love of God, how rich and pure. measureless and strong. It shall forevermore endure the saints and angels' song. It shall forevermore endure the saints and angels' song.
Love of God, of whom we are the recipients. I don't know about you, that makes the hair stand on the back of my neck to think that the Creator of everything gave everything for you and me. It's not powerful. Oh, we serve a great God.
The Lord bless those lovely hymns, John, and your words tonight. And it is wonderful, indeed unbelieving, that the God of love, the God of heaven, should send His only begotten Son into this world for hell guilty sinners such as we. But that's the gospel. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. May God bless those lovely hymns, John, to all of our hearts. Let me again welcome each and every one along to the meeting tonight. It's encouraging to see so many here this evening. And if you're visiting, we give you a very warm welcome. And for those that are tuning in through the social media, we give you a welcome as well, and we do pray that you'll enjoy the meeting tonight. There's just a few announcements very, very quickly that I want to make at this part of the service, and I'll go through them as quickly as I can. Tuesday night, we have the prayer meeting here at 8 p.m., and as we announced this morning, Mr. Richard Edwards will be coming along to take the prayer meeting on Tuesday night. So do come along and support him. And I believe that you'll enjoy this young man as he comes to preach and to bring God's word. Now, there's no little treasures this week on the Wednesday morning because of the midterm break. But do please remember to continue to pray for this work in the days that lie ahead. But on Wednesday evening at 6:30 p.m., we're meeting here at the church again to go out to give out the invitations for the gospel mission that we're starting next Sunday night in a hoary orange hall. I'd like to thank all of those who went out last Wednesday and those that went out last Thursday evening as well. Now, the immediate area around the orange hall has been done, but there's about 300 or 400 leaflets left, and we'll be going out on Wednesday night to give out the rest of them in the will of the Lord. So if you can join with us, you'd be very welcome to come along and do so, please, on Wednesday evening. Then Friday night, there's no children's meeting and no children's meeting plus this Friday night because of the midterm break. But there is a youth fellowship meeting, young people, at 8 p.m. So please remember your meeting on Friday evening. And another announcement in connection with the youth fellowship, on Saturday the 26th of November, just a date for your diary, there'll be a craft fair and coffee morning here in the church hall. And that's to raise some funds for the youth fellowship. And that will be from 10 in the morning until 1 p.m. So do please keep that date free, if at all possible. Next Lord's Day, the Sunday school and the Bible class is at 10:15. The service is here at 11:30 and 6:30 p.m. And I'll be preaching at both services in the will of the Lord next Lord's Day. And our sister Hannah Simpson will be here next Sunday night to sing in the gospel. Now, next Sunday night also commences the gospel mission in a hoary orange hall. We've been praying for it. I'd like to thank all of those who have come to the early morning prayer meetings over these past 4 weeks on the Friday morning, and also all who came along to the prayer meeting this afternoon. And we were encouraged with the spirit of prayer that there has been. But the time has come to put feet to our prayers. And the mission will commence next Sunday night at 8 o'clock in the Orange Hall. And next Sunday night, the Reverend David Park, God willing, will be along to preach. And also, of course, during the week, the Reverend Morrow, John Morrow, will be preaching, and our brother Fred Greenfield, and I'll preach a few nights maybe as well. And there'll be someone along to sing every night at the mission. So please, please remember this gospel mission and come along as many nights as possible. Now, there are leaflets at the door, especially for our visitors. Feel free to take one or as many as you need. And we invite you along, if you're visiting tonight, to come along to the mission and we know that you will enjoy it night by night. Now, there's supper for everyone this evening as well, so don't be rushing home. If you can wait behind after the meeting, we'll be going through this door, through the link into the church hall. The ladies of the congregation have provided a lovely supper, so please wait behind tonight for your supper. Now, I think that's all the announcement. We're going to sing another hymn, and the offering for the Lord's work is going to be taken up. It's hymn number 330 in the hymn book. And what a lovely hymn it is. Since Christ my soul from sin set free, this world has been a heaven to me amid our sorrows and its woe. 'Tis heaven my Jesus here to know. We'll keep our seats for the first couple of verses. Ask John to come again and bring us his final message and song. Thank you, John.
I've wandered far away from God. Now I'm coming home. The paths of sin too long I've trod. Lord, I'm coming home. Coming home, never more to roam. me home. I've wasted many, many precious years. Lord, I'm coming home. I now repent with bitter, bitter tears. Lord, I'm coming home. I've tired of sin and straying, Lord. Is that you? Lord, I'm coming home. I'll trust thy love, believe thy word. Lord, I'm coming home. Coming home. Coming home. Nevermore to roam. Open wide thine arms of love. Lord, I'm coming home.
Will you join me in a chorus?
Coming home, coming home, nevermore to roam. Oh,
again, we'd like to thank John for coming along tonight. We do appreciate his ministry, and we do pray that the Lord will continue to bless him as he serves the Lord in this way. We're delighted tonight to have a good friend and brother, George Hewitt, with us this evening. And we'd like to thank George for coming tonight to give his testimony, to tell us how the Lord has saved him and how the Lord has kept him right up to this present day. George, you're very welcome, and we pray that as you give your testimony now, that the Lord will bless you indeed. Bless. Bless, George.
And if you have your Bibles with you, if I could ask you just to open it at Deuteronomy chapter 33 and the verse 27. And while you're looking it up, can I say what a joy and a privilege it is to be able to stand here tonight and give a word of testimony to you all. I'd also like to thank the Reverend John Gray for the very kind words of welcome and the welcome here tonight. It says in Deuteronomy 33 and the verse 27, "The eternal God is thy refuge, and underneath are the everlasting arms. And he shall thrust out the enemy from before thee, and shall say, destroy them." You know, when it says there, the eternal God, that means there's no better. So who other arms would we want to be in, holding us, other than the eternal God? You know, when I was preparing for tonight, I'd asked the Lord to help prepare me with a simple message of testimony, which would show what a wonderful saving Savior we have. And as I thought and prayed for help, I couldn't stop reflecting back on my life and how, even though so many times I failed God, he never left me. As the words in Isaiah 41, verse 10 say, "And one I take great comfort from many, many times. Fear thou not, for I am with thee. Be not dismayed, for I am thy God. I will strengthen thee, yea, I will help thee, yea, I will uphold thee with the right hand of thy righteousness." I know as we all sit here tonight, and if we were to reflect back on our time spent here on earth, we most likely at some point would say, if I could live life again, I would do it differently. Well, if I'm honest, I would say the same. But as we all know, we can't. And how important it is to live life with the love of Jesus with us all day, every day. For the benefit of those who don't know me, my name is George Hewitt, and I was born on the 7th of November 1964 into a loving family of two older brothers and one older sister. And to see if anybody getting the calculators out, you'll probably know I'm 58 in a few days' time. So we were all brought up in a small country holding where we were in the vegetable fields from a very early age to help and work the land. It was one day when I was 12 years old as I walked home from school and was then helping out in the evenings in the neighbour's vegetable field that the Lord came to me and I spoke to the owner, Dennis Lass, who was a saved man and had spoke many times about Jesus to me when we worked in the fields, that I said I needed to get saved. When we left the field, we then left the field and went into the comfort of his own home, where as a boy, I knelt and gave my life to God at that time. But you know, life as a Christian doesn't always mean there won't be trials and troubles, probably far from the truth. And indeed, walking the Christian life, especially when we are stubborn in our ways and we think we can run life our way, can be a life of disappointment, failures, and sadness. This, I have to say, would at times have summed me up in such few words. But also, all testimonies don't always come with a great story behind them, as mine was just as what the simple message of Jesus Christ is. And the hymn writer penned those wonderful words, just saved by grace alone. As I continued to reflect back on my life as a Christian, the Lord has continually made me consider the blessings that have been blessed on me. One of such blessings was on October the 26th, 1985, I was to get married to Stephanie, and who has given me two wonderful children, Catherine and Jonathan, of which Catherine has given us two wonderful grandchildren, Jack and Abby. But as I move on in the years, and the years passed by, I realized that a large part of my life was somewhat like a parent, watching their children grow. And as they learn to walk, they will run and crawl in front of you, and they'll run and run until they trip and fall. But we are there to pick them up, put our arms around them for comfort and reassurance. It is this example that I feel represents a large part of my relationship with God, because I would run the path of life just slightly in front of God, but always trying to keep an arm's length of Jesus. So when I made a mistake or fail, I hope God was there to pick me up. And yes, to be honest, as I said at the start in Deuteronomy, the eternal God is thy refuge. And yes, God never failed. He was and is my refuge. And for me, it was simply, I failed God each and every time. It's God's grace that I stand here, covered by his blood, that during some of the most trying times, God gave me such grace and understanding. And to highlight just a few of these was one when my father, at the age of 54, left home that morning for a serious operation in the Royal Victoria Hospital in Belfast, but was called into eternity that day as complications developed during the operation. And as a young man of 21 years of age and only married some 4 months, it was indeed a very difficult and trying time. And it left me with not understanding my own life, but not also my relationship with God. But again, God was merciful and showed me his love as it was later that year our wonderful daughter Catherine was born. As time moved on, and I really want to get to the part of my life where God spoke and showed himself in a way that is indeed both overwhelming and amazing to myself. But there's certain other things that take place as well. You know, I had a heart attack at 44. I was involved in a fatal road crash some years just prior to that. So, you know, we could talk about all the things that has happened. but God was always there. And it was my stubbornness that made me think, I come through these on my own. I didn't give God the glory. I didn't thank God for bringing me through these things. I was that stubborn Christian who thought he was better than anybody else. And I asked myself why I felt that way. The simple answer would have been, I had done nothing to even come close to deserve his love and blessings. But before I do that, I just need to briefly reflect back when I was at the age of 13, that during a bicycle accident, I was to find myself in A&E, going through emergency surgery to have my ruptured spleen removed, and was told if I had not went to hospital that night, I would surely have passed away into eternity during the night. I am mentioning this tonight as it has a very strong part to play in what I want to share with you tonight. As I mentioned earlier, when we run in front of God as a Christian, what we are actually doing with our lives is leaving a gap between ourselves and God. And as time went on, I would increase that gap, until at times I wouldn't even look back to see if God was there. It's this gap which the devil was all too quick to fill, all too quick to play the doubting mind games, all too quick to make us question our God, and all too quick to make us answer our faith, or at worst, not even think of our faith at all. And so sometimes, because of this, God takes control. And as a result, that means being in a valley of despair, sickness, to enable us to reach to Him for that comfort and hold on to the everlasting arms of our Lord and Savior. Just as I mentioned earlier, like the child needs the parents when they fall. As we now jump on to recent years, I suppose my life and my relationship with God did change, and I would have to say for the better. As I was asked in December 2019 by the Reverend McMillan, Minister of Armagh Free Presbyterian Church, to testify on the last Sunday night of December 2019. Now, to my shame, this was the first time in my life that I had spoken publicly about being a Christian. And people say the more you do it, the easier it becomes. And I can certainly give a different opinion on that. But you know, even then the devil for weeks had put every doubt, every fear, every scenario that he could think of to make me say no. Even to the point when Mr. McMillan asked me again, I said to him, to be quite honest, I would rather sing instead of speaking. And of course, those who know Mr. McMillan, he quickly turned it straight back to me and said, that's okay, George, don't worry, you can do both. But you know, this was to be the start of a journey I never once thought I would ever be on, or even able, in God's eyes, to fulfill it. But God's ways are not our ways, and that I can assure you all, it certainly wasn't my way. That night passed, and I can say to anyone who is asked to testify, please take the opportunity and just leave it with the Lord. For He will truly bless you, because I have no doubt in my mind, if I hadn't testified that night and spoken about the things of my life, that what was about to take place 13 months later, the outcome and the experience from being seriously ill would have been somewhat different. As we are all too aware, it was soon after 2019 that COVID pandemic swallowed our world and country. And it was in January 2021, just after returning from the Christmas break, that I was in work and had developed a cough. But anyone who knows me, this was quite normal for me over the winter months due to having no spleen. I now remember what I said in early regards to losing my spleen all those years ago. So that night, I got a text from one of my employees to inform me that he tested positive from COVID. And as a routine at that time, the company policy was we all had to enroll in getting tested the next day. It soon became clear that I was to test positive as well. and therefore to isolate at home, and so I did. But as the days passed by, the cough would deepen, and the sickness came, and after some days in bed, being spoon-fed, and oxygen levels being constantly monitored by my wonderful wife, and she's not here tonight, so I can say these things, so and it soon became very clear that things were not as they should be. But it was on the Tuesday morning, around 7 a.m., that Stephanie came to take the usual readings, and at that point, feed me. At that point, we're all within the guidelines until approximately 9 a.m. Things would deteriorate. And Stephanie came into the room realizing that as my breathing at that point was very shallow, very labored, and extremely painful. And as she held me to comfort me, the only words I could say was, "I can't do this any longer." At which point, I put my head on the pillow and I waited for whatever would happen next. It was at this point, Stephanie had left the room, unknowing to me, but had called the medics, the doctors, and I'm told it was only approximately 15 minutes till an ambulance was at my house. The only thing I remembered at that point was two paramedics around my bed, administering oxygen, heart machines, etc., and being transferred to the emergency ward in Craigavon Area Hospital. Unfortunately, things again would take a turn for the worse, and as there was a very high possibility that organs were coming under serious pressure, I was removed from the cubicle to somewhere else, of which in the hospital I have no idea where that was. It was around 10 a.m. or 10 p.m. that night that I was taken to the CT scanner to have it confirmed that I had pneumonia, double pneumonia in both lungs, and multiple clots in both lungs. Now, for those who maybe don't know what the spleen does, is an organ that retains white blood cells, so that when your body's infected, it's released to fight the infection. So you can understand the complications. It was soon after the scan that one of the great nurses, and they were great nurses, rubbed my arm and asked me to look at a window. And there looking through the window was my niece Victoria, who is a nurse. But as I was in the red zone ward, even she wasn't allowed to open the door to say hello. It was at this point I feel this was indeed the start, where God was indeed setting all in place to show me that he, and only he, was in charge. Because if you look at it, the ambulance was at the house in 15 minutes. The doctors and the wards were mesmerized as how they were going to treat what they were treating. But it was then I realized that here I am. No family at my side. And God was indeed showing himself to me in such an unbelievable way that it was to make me feel that I'm here, but I'm not here, if that makes sense. Soon after, I was admitted to the COVID ward, where soon after, the doctors, consultants, would come to my bedside to explain the test results and what the plan would be. And remember this part very, very clearly. And most likely will for the rest of my days. As the consultant commented, sat down in bed and said, "George, you're a very poorly young man, and how would you like me to tell me what I want to know?" And those here who know me, as I always am one who likes the truth, no fudging or dressing it up, so to speak. But what he was about to say was indeed something, if I'm honest, I was not expecting. But in saying that, I was glad he said it as straight as he did, and the words were quite simple. "George, as you know, you have pneumonia and multiple clots in both lungs, and we have been fighting all day to contain the spread of the infection. But the fact you don't have a spleen is a big worry, and as a result, we have to administer these antibodies, which have only been developed due to COVID-19. Again, here we have God's grace. These antibodies, never developed before, and I had lost my spleen some 40-odd years ago, and was always warned by the doctors, you cannot afford to get pneumonia because you will not fight it. But we have no idea how they will work with you due to you losing your spleen. So the next 12 hours is completely over to you and how your body. And his words, again, I never forget. And I trust to see you in the morning. So the next part is we will administer the antibodies and we will attach the CP mask for the high volume of oxygen to be admitted, and the nurses will take over at that point. But again, God was in control. And again, that feeling of being present but not present in the ward that night was so evident, and something I haven't spoken much about publicly, but I felt this time I needed to highlight it, as the pain was bearable, the mask was bearable, which some people struggle to even have it on their face, with the high level of oxygen being forced into your lungs. But again, God gave me a peace. And even though the nurses were at my bedside most of the night and would turn me from side to side every hour, I felt that night was that of comfort and contentment. Soon the morning came, and even the doctors were amazed to see me sitting up and even managing a small cup of tea and a piece of toast. So we see God's will in his grace answer prayer. As I know, a lot of prayer from all over the country was indeed made that night. And the days after, for my return to health, and for that, I will always be grateful. As soon as it was down to the loving prayers that night, as I was weak and frail, and unworthy in mine eyes to be even blessed in this manner. Now, yes, the rest of 2021 was, don't get me wrong, full of highs, full of lows, but what it has taught me is to never walk, or in my case, run in front of God, as he is thy refuge, and underneath are the everlasting arms. So when we got home, certain things had to be recalibrated. I had to learn to walk. I had no voice. Mind you, the wife's prayers were answered. That was for approximately 68 weeks. But all such things came back. I was able to walk. Now, don't get me wrong, I certainly wouldn't do 45 minutes or 90 minutes around Shamrock Park football pitch, and I certainly wouldn't do 10 seconds with Mike Tyson, but I'm here, and I've got a God who loves me, and a God who I am very, very willing to praise. So the main message I want to leave tonight is, how can we be in God's everlasting arms if we're running in front of him or far away from him? So just before I finish, and I will be quick, I just want to leave with you the words of a song which I listened to many times during my recovery and still listen to today, which has had a long-lasting impact on my life for two reasons. One, if God had called me home that night, what explanation would I have given for my life? Because I can honestly say here, it wouldn't have been a good one. Oh yes, God had saved me. That was assured. But did I represent God? Not many times. So things had to change. But it's a simple question, and it can be applied to those who know Jesus as their Savior. But more importantly, if you're here tonight and you've not yet met the Savior, then I hope and trust these words will make you understand the importance of your soul and how you need to get right with God. And it simply just goes like this. If Jesus comes tomorrow to spend some time with you, would you answer all his questions or lie to hide the truth? Would you welcome him with open arms or even let him in? If Jesus comes tomorrow, what then? If Jesus calls your number, could you leave today? Are you ready to lay down your worldly goods and walk away? Would it take a month of Sundays just to tell him off your sin? If Jesus comes tomorrow, what then? If the sky turns black as midnight in the middle of the day, and somehow you knew that Jesus would soon be on his way, would you have to beg forgiveness, or could you reach out and take his hand? If Jesus comes tomorrow, what then? Thank you.
Well, I'd like to thank George for coming along tonight and giving that simple, straightforward word of testimony. And how true it is, child of God, that we need to live for the Lord now. In a few moments, I'm going to ask John to sing another hymn. He doesn't know this, but he knows it now. And he's going to close the meeting with singing a hymn. But let me just give you that challenge again to all of us. The Lord Jesus is coming again. Someday he's going to burst the clouds asunder, and he's going to come back to this earth. My friend, how are you and I going to meet the Savior? If the Lord was to come back tonight, you know what the Lord Jesus said before he left this scene of time concerning his second coming? He said, "Be ye also ready. For in such an hour as ye think not, the Son of Man cometh." He's coming again suddenly. He's coming again in all his glory. He's coming again to judge this world. He's coming again to receive the saints home to heaven. He's coming again to rule and to reign. But the question is, will you rule and reign with him? Will you go home to be with Christ when he comes again, or will you be lost? I pray that even tonight, that you will make your peace with God. You need to be saved. You need to trust Christ as your Redeemer, whoever you are. But thank God you can be saved tonight because of the one who died and rose again. The Lord Jesus loved you so much that he gave his life upon the cross, a ransom for the many. And there upon Calvary, he shed his precious blood in order to provide eternal salvation for you and for me. God commendeth his love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Come to Christ tonight and trust him. John, sing us a final piece, and then I'll close in a wee word of prayer. Amen.
What a wonderful word of testimony. Isn't that just amazing? This is just a weak question. Soon we'll come to the end of life's journey, and perhaps we'll never meet anymore. Till we gather in heaven's bright city, far away on that beautiful shore. If we never meet again this side of heaven, as we struggle through this world and its strife,
There's another meeting place somewhere in heaven, by the side of God's river of life, where those charming roses bloom forever, and where separation comes no if we never meet again this side of heaven. I will meet you on that beautiful shore.
You know, it's only a song, and it's only asking a question, and it just happens to be put to a wee tune. But listen, what you decide to do here has an eternal consequence on where you will end up there. And I trust that I meet every single one of you, and those watching on online, in that wonderful city that Christ is building, the New Jerusalem, hallelujah, that's bought for us by his blood.
If we never meet again this side of heaven, as we struggle through this world and its strife, there's another meeting place somewhere in heaven, by the side of God's river of life, where those charming roses bloom forever, and where separation comes no more if we never meet again this side of heaven. I will meet you on God's beautiful shore. Yes, if we never meet again this side of heaven,
tell me this.
Will I meet you? Will I meet you? Will I meet you? Will I meet you? Will I meet you on God's beautiful shore?
I trust I see every single one of you on God's shore someday. It's only a song. That's asking a very, very important question. Oh, I trust I meet you all that day.
Folks, let's all bow in a wee word of prayer. Our Father in heaven, we thank thee for your presence in the meeting tonight. We thank thee for George's testimony. Thank thee for saving him and keeping him in thy will. And Lord, we pray that you'll help us all, those of us who are saved, not to walk before thee, but to just keep one step behind thee. Help us to follow thee. Lord, we recognize that those in the Bible, when they got saved, it says they followed Jesus. Oh God, we confess, like George, many times we have ran on before thee, and we've done things we shouldn't have done. And oh God, we need to stay close to thee. Lord, if there's someone here tonight and they're saved, but they're not walking with thee the way they ought to be walking with thee, perhaps they're cold in their Christian life, just as George was, we pray tonight that you would draw them back to thee. And, oh God, that you would restore the years that the locusts have eaten. And, Lord, as you bless George in his life, now that he wants to serve thee, that you would bless them in their lives. Oh God, we've only one life, and it'll soon be past, and only what's done for Jesus will last. Help us to walk with thee, Lord, day by day, and serve thee with all our hearts. For those that are not saved, Lord, they have never taken that step of faith. Oh God, save them tonight. And we pray that you'll draw them to the cords of Calvary love. We thank thee for the food that has been prepared for us. Thank thee for those that have prepared it. And bless the food to our bodies, and help us to eat and drink to your glory. And bless our fellowship the one with the other tonight. For us in Jesus' precious, precious name we ask it. Lord, for those who have to go home now, we pray that you'll bring them to our homes in safety. And then afterwards, Lord, that we'll all go home in safety. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen. Amen. Folks, we do welcome you all to stay behind. Invite you all to stay behind for a supper, a cup of tea. If you can, indeed, you'll be made very, very welcome. I'm going to go through these doors here, so it's just a matter of coming up to the front, and the ladies will be there to serve you. But thank you so much for coming tonight, and please remember the meetings next week, and remember the mission. Pray for it and come along. You'll be made very, very welcome. Thank you. Thank you. Morning.